Praise Lord. No sacrifice, it is a privilege. Respected pastor, judges, parents, and my dear friends, I bring you greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today, the topic given to me is, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, there is no sacrifice too great for me to make for him. But before getting into the word of God, let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, our gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for giving me this wonderful privilege to stand before you with the word of God. Lord, please be with me and guide me. All glory and honor to thy name. In the name of Jesus, I ask, amen. Let's turn our scriptures to Psalms 116, verse 12 and 14. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits towards me? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord, now in the presence of all his people. C.T. Studd has said, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, there is no sacrifice too great for me to make for him. I agree this statement wholeheartedly and would like to tell you why I mean so. But I also agree to Dr. David Livingstone, who said, if a commission by an earthly king is considered to be an honor, why is a commission of the heavenly king considered to be a sacrifice? People talk about the sacrifice they do in Africa, China, etc. But it's emphatically not a sacrifice. Say rather, it is a privilege. I think we are once again looking at a paradox at its best. For the world, it might look like a huge sacrifice, giving up all their pleasures and living a lifestyle they love. But for the person who is answering to God's call, it suddenly becomes the best thing that he or him has ever done. Now, how is this possible? It is not possible with us, but it is possible with God. Self-preservation is the way of the world, but self-sacrifice is the way of the God empowered with Holy Spirit. Catherine Booth equips us this way. Whatever the particular call is, whatever the sacrifice God asks you to make, the particular cross he wishes you to embrace, you should be ready enough to say, oh Lord, yes, I am ready to do it and obey it without facing the consequences. But what we say is, I don't know what will happen next. But no, none of us will know what will happen next. But we know that we shall be safe in his hands. Until we take the leap of faith to follow God's calling, we don't know the blessings that are attached to the sacrifice we are about to make. Now, according to the scripture that we just read, there are three important things that we could repay God for his amazing love shown to us. Firstly, I will take up the cup of salvation. Sadly, many people, after seeing their cup of salvation, do not lift it up and to see that the Lord is good. We could possibly never repay Jesus for his death on the cross for our sins. But he is the living water. He is the river of life. He makes us do good things and produces good fruits in us, which are the fruits of the Spirit. Secondly, I will call upon the name of the Lord. If we want to show God our appreciation, even though we could never repay him completely for our salvation, we could take time to learn and pray and to trust our dependable and loving God. He should be the first in our love and the first in whom we turn. And for that, we can remind ourselves to pray before we speak or act. In Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, we read, and without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Thirdly, I will fulfill my vows to the Lord. Fulfilling our vows is one of the most important things that we should do in repaying for what God did for us. That is by sending Jesus to the earth to save us from the eternal death. Fulfilling our vows contains seven simple steps, which are step one. In Matthew chapter 18 verse 1, we read, Jesus telling the disciples to be childlike and to possess their innocence. We must humble ourselves and possess what their innocence is. Step two, being children, we should never be willfully rebellious, sinful, and be of corruption. We must be holy. Then only we can abide with Him. Step 3. We must be obedient to the Word of God. We must learn to obey the commandments of the Lord and live a life which He requires. Step 4. We should have a Christ-centered and Spirit-filled life. This means that we should possess the fruit of the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit, and understand the standard of Christian living. Step 5. In Romans chapter 12 verse 1, we read, to offer our bodies as living sacrifices. And that is the key point. God created each one of us in this world to live a life according to Him and to obey His will. So we on this earth are supposed to live a life, supposed to offer our bodies as living sacrifices and without conforming to this world. Step 6, we are called for doing the good works and to live a life pleasing to God. And step 7, most importantly, we must be a born again. And that is why Jesus came on the cross and redeemed us. We must accept that Jesus died for us and live a life according to Him. Now in conclusion, let me sum up the points. We can take Frederick's famous quote, which is, the place God tells you is where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger rest. We are powered by the Holy Spirit. Hence, we can be bold and say like David Livingstone, without Christ, not one step, and with Him, anyway. So may God bless you abundantly with these words.